I expect other papers have already started on to a certain extent, but unfortunately I haven't heard them. So I am speaking a little blind, both in that I can't see you, and I also don't know what's been said. So please forgive me, and feel free to say in the questions that what I'm saying has been said before. The work that I'm talking about here is something that I'm doing as part of the Heritage Futures Project. You can see the people who are supporting the Heritage Futures Project here. I've only put up UCL and Linnaeus. I've only put up UCL and Linnaeus because those people I'm working with most closely, but it also is supported by York University and Exeter University, and by our funding partners, and most importantly by the AHRC. You can have their logo at the top. We go to the next slide, second. Right, I'll do that. Yes? Okay? Okay, so now we have our second slide. The Heritage Futures Project. Myself and Seth spoke about it last year, so some of you will have heard about it, but for those who haven't, it's a major Heritage Future project run through the AHRC, which explores heritage as future-making practice. So basically, we're interested in the way that future presents itself, heritage presents itself as being about the future, that we are doing things for the future. And if we're doing things for the future, what kinds of things are we doing, and what do those things do themselves? The key features of it, though, that it's a comparative program, so we're trying to compare different kinds of practices, and we're working with practitioners in quite an intimate and ethnographic fashion, rather than simply doing the work ourselves, which makes it a little easy. We have four themes, under the titles of uncertainty, transformation, profusion, and diversity. I'm going to speak today about the work that I'm doing as part of the uncertainty theme, but if you look at our website, which the address is at the bottom of all the slides, you can find out about the other four themes as well. I think that's probably the quickest way to deal with that. Seth is on the diversity theme, so any of you want to work out changing, go look at that. Next slide. Okay, so this is the uncertainty theme. The uncertainty theme deals with the uncertainty of the deeper distant future. So the key question that we're asking is, what do we mean when we say forever? How is that uncertainty conceived and managed in different fields of practice? And the three comparative fields that we're looking at are World Heritage Site Management, Nuclear Waste Management, and Deep Space Messaging. Those may not seem immediately like obvious fields of practice to compare, but what we're looking at is that all of those types of practices have an audience that is in the distant future. World Heritage Sites regularly say that we're preserving essentially forever. There's no sense of an end on that. Nuclear waste management, of course, nuclear waste will stay active for at least 100,000 years, and so it needs to be managed for that time. And deep space messaging is messages that are being sent to space with an audience presumed to be after the death of humanity. So those are three very different kinds of deep futures that are being pointed at, and we want to look at what kinds of practices those are. But it wouldn't really be a heritage project if it was in that really obscure and abstract sense. It does have fieldwork, and my fieldwork is in the late history. Hence my question, is the late history a little area? So, when we chose the late district to be the place where we did the fieldwork with this theme, we chose it because it is a candidate World Heritage Site. So the World Heritage Site management practices are both present and being interrogated and contested at the moment. It's also alongside what's referred to as the Energy Coast. Can you use the laser pointer to point at the Energy Coast there, Seth?
I don't know, can I?
Okay, so this the Energy Coast is a euphemism for the area which is where is the Energy Coast? It's just a coast. Yeah, it's okay. in fact, that whole coast is basically clear, because in addition to the Energy Coast, which is a way of talking about Sellafield without saying the name, the most of the nuclear fleet is based more kind of south of it. So this area is surrounded by nuclear features, and as we'll come on to, in addition to being the site of the world's first nuclear power station that has also had an incredible tangle of other activities, it's also the place that is the candidate for the geological repository for nuclear waste, in the strongest candidate for, even though it's officially been dropped, it is the strongest candidate for the geological repository in the UK. There's also a dark skies reserve in the very near to the ancient coast, in fact, but inside the national park. Dark skies reserves are places that are managed for the lack of light pollution, and so they are used for outreach and public activities associated with astronomy, and so their connection to the deep space messages are there as well. So in one place, we're able to look at these three different kinds of features and how they play. So that's why we're there. Now, the next slide. You all know what the lake district looks like, right? This is what the lake district looks like in everybody's imagination. And in one sense, you look at a picture like that, and there is an absurdity to saying, is this rural? Because in some ways, it's almost the definition of rural for a lot of English people. But I want to query that because of the fact that it, as the category, doesn't have very clear edges. So this is actually a picture of Thornycrake Farm, which was owned by a private landowner who was farming it at the time the photograph was taken. But the farmland has recently been bought by the National Trust, who are the biggest landowner in the Lake District and do most of the land management. And the land has been bought by the Trust, but not the farmhouse. So if you point the farmhouse there, there you go, that was separated as a separate lot by the people selling. And the National Trust did not bid for the farmhouse, they just bid for the land. And the people in the Lake District, there was a major outcry about this because of that, but if you separate the land and the farm, then the suggestion is that the land will not be a farm, that the house will become a tourist let, and the land will be managed for other values other than farming. And that's certainly the concern of people in the Lake District. We'll come back a little bit to what kinds of values it might be managed for. But it does flag that property dealings within the Lake District are not property dealings in the way that they are in many agricultural settings, because the value of the land has floated free from its use value. It's floated free from what you make it as a farm. It now is largely about land speculation, which is, of course, much more similar to the way the property values are managed within an urban area. So then that starts to ask the question, is this a rural area if its property values, its valuation systems, economic values, are the values of cities? But of course, the other thing, if we move on to the next slide, that makes us feel like the Lake District is a rural area is that it is quiet and empty and all about solitude. This picture should now be a picture of Grasmere in the fog. And so that draws us to the fact that the Lake District was the home and the muse of Wordsworth, who is, of course, one of the great rural poets, so we have to think of it as rural because he represented it as rural. But this notion of solitude and freedom that is called to in that kind of poetry has very little to do with contemporary experiences of the Lake District. The next slide, shows a sign at the edge of the National Park, which looks like most signs out in the middle of nowhere. Does it not?
Yeah.
Okay, so I thought you were looking at me, it doesn't show that there. Okay, so the the sign is, as always is the case on the edges of heritage managed places, a list of things that we're not allowed to do. And it calls to mind the fact that in addition to having the values of the property values of a city, it also has the same kinds of controls on behavior as a lot of urban areas. And he's managed, in fact, through an increasingly Byzantine set of committees, many different kinds of bodies working together. So, for instance, the World Heritage Site bid itself is not managed by any one driving force, but by a partnership. I think it's 15 different organizations managing that bid. So that, again, is another thing that it shares with urban areas, in that complexity of management structures and what would have been more like guilds in the original conception about urban areas. Now, if we move on to the next slide, also point out that the notion of solitude and quietness that is in people's minds about the Lake District is, of course, really to do with an imagination rather than to do with an experience. And while a number of people resident in the Lake District is still relatively low in terms of the density of housing of people resident, the density of people who are present in the Lake District is very high. It's one of the highest densities of tourist activity outside of London that you get in the UK. And in that, it has, again, a lot of similarities with, say, the City of London, where you have a very low resident population, but a very high daily population of people coming in. So you have a high transient population, and that high transient population is not really something that would have been traditionally associated with the rural. So in that sense, I would call it the question of whether that's rural. Move on. And the next thing, these again are lovely bucolic pictures of the rural area of the Lake District, but these are actually photographs of Thirlmere reservoir, which is one of the things that looks like a lake when you looked at that original map. But it is in fact a reservoir, and it's not just a reservoir of water for local use, it's a reservoir of water for use in Manchester. Now, my abstract says that it was set up in 1984. That was a typo. It's 1894, not 1984. So just to be clear about that, it's the whole of the 20th century that Manchester has had been drawing its water from the Lake District. And the way in which this connection to the major urban and industrial centre of Manchester is made more comfortable and more rural is through the use of these heritage tropes, castles, and of crests and coats of arms. And so there is this sense that this is it maintains its nature of being rural, despite the fact that it is physically and structurally connected to Manchester. And in fact, the infrastructure that takes the water through is quite disruptive to that entire area, but has been very much papered over so that we don't look at that water there, so we can maintain this fantasy of a rural area. So, and this connection to Manchester is also a cultural one, because one of the great authors of the Lake District, Wainwright, who set up the walking guides to Lake District, that are one of the main ones that really did it as an escape from Manchester. And one of the National Trust employees that I've been speaking to as part of my work says that he thinks, if we move on to the next slide, that really the Lake District is a shadow of a shadow place of Manchester. The Lake District only exists as it is because Manchester exists as it does, and Manchester only exists as it does because the Lake District exists as it does. And this notion of a shadow, the urban, the rural as a shadow of the urban, I think says something about the way that the urban is conceived, urban and the rural are conceived in Britain today, because really, the rural can only exist as something which is now described as that which isn't urban. Whereas in earlier periods, you might put the fact phrase the other way around, that the urban was what was not rural. But the two are linked in that way. So, having said that I don't think, the short answer to my original question is no, is the link is to the rural area. I would say no, because I don't think that the category of being a rural area is necessarily useful, because the ways in which we define it, it's too much of a blunt instrument. And I would, just to throw in some theory names so I don't feel like a complete fraud, I would say that you know, if you look at the fact that people like Ruskin and indeed more recently Rackham, we would think of many different kinds of categories that weren't urban. But these days we've kind of caught it down to being urban or rural or kind of two categories. I know from some pieces that Paul would start having some comments about that at the beginning. I'm waiting for time. Am I running out? Okay. I'm going to go very quickly, Ben. If you could just skip me through, give me the next slide. And then, okay, this is a picture of Emmerdale Water, which is it's important both because of the fact that it is placed under which is the best candidate for the geological repository for nuclear waste, but also because its watershed has been switched by the National Trust to be managed in a way that they refer to as rewilded. And this rewilding is not the same as the introduction of the links that you may have read about. It's about not managing the water courses in the same way. So there are these two very different notions of the future that are embedded in the same place, in that the geological repository is about holding on to nuclear waste for a period that is at least 20,000 years, and it's about holding on, whereas the rewilding is very much about letting go. I'm sorry, it would have gone longer on that, but I don't have time, so I shall go on a little bit. And could you just go through the next two slides very quickly and move them to two slides on, and then share my hand with a black lump in it.
Yeah, yes? This is Sarah's son.
My hand with a black lump is that black lump is a lump of Nyrex wax, and it represents the amount of nuclear waste that it would be generated by an ordinary British person's use of electricity through their lifetime. So there I am holding on to my own nuclear waste. But of course, there's a lot more than just my handful, and that's that question about that idyllic picture of Emmerdale that I put forward a second ago. How does that come through when we start thinking about it in relation to these industrial processes? And we move the next one now, and we have would be a lecture from me. It didn't have a picture from the zoo. This is the latest zoo, and you can see there in the middle the lynx, that's where the lynx lives in the Lake District at the moment. But part of the rewilding suggestions that are being put forward is that lynx will be reintroduced into the Lake District. So this is a new conflict, but we've got is the rural the agricultural one that in fact the World Heritage Site values are for, or is the rural a wild rural? And what does it mean to say that it's a wild rural? Those are different kinds of futures. If we move to the next slide, the next slide is of a bridge that was washed away in last winter's floods. And that is the kind of rewilding that the National Trust are talking about. Not, of course, flooding, not, of course, washing away bridges, but their concern with changing the drainage system is to stop the flooding, given the increased rainfall. So that's, again, we can't necessarily manage it the way that it has been managed. What kind of interventions do we need to have in this rural area for it to work? Okay, I'm gonna jump through then to the next two slides. Next three slides, just jump through them a sec.
To design?
Yeah, through past design and onto the black and white picture. Okay. This is a screenshot from the Telegraph from the 13th of October, talking about that disagreement regarding the sale of land that I spoke about at the beginning of the talk. And this is how the Telegraph chooses to illustrate a story about a property dispute in the Lake District with a photograph that they say themselves is from 1906. So there is this notion that this is the real Lake District, and that the National Trust is messing around with by making it anything other than this 1906 black and white vision. And so if we go to the last slide, then I'll finish up with what I actually feel I want to say about this, which is that I think that in some way the perception of a place being rural is really about temporality. There are these notions of timelessness, these notions of, that there shouldn't be change, that it's okay to represent a place with a photograph of it from 1906. And then there's also the fact that a lot of future making practices that are touched on today are really about revival. Whether that revival be of foul shepherding through the World Heritage Site bid cultural landscape of foul shepherding, or whether that be through rewilding, some notion that there was a period in which the place was wild and be brought back to that. The future making practices are very much about the past. And I wonder whether that's partly because we are in this kind of area that we put aside to be this, to be the shadow of the urban, that these shadow urban places hold on to the past, so then urban areas can be figured as places that will hold on to futures. So that's some thoughts around the matter. I hope that any of it makes sense. I have to say it's an odd experience. So do feel free to ask me further questions as well as to argue with me.